Hello again, it's Fiona from the NCBE. Thank you for signing in for part two of our DNA module. So I left you previously in part one, having looked at the structure of DNA and RNA, and we looked at the history of DNA. And we finished with Meselson and Stahl's seminal experiment showing that DNA replicated semi-conservatively. So how does it actually do this? Well, in this video, we are going to cover how DNA actually replicates, and we're then going to have a look at what happens when errors in replication lead to mutations. And we're going to have a look at the disease cystic fibrosis, which is a genetic disease caused by mutations in the Cfgr gene. Okay, so let's get started then with DNA replication. So we now know that DNA replicates by what we call semi-conservative replication. But how does it actually do this? So let's look now at a little bit more detail at how DNA replicates. So this process works by the two original strands acting as a template for the production of the two new strands of DNA. So first, the DNA obviously must be unwound from its tightly coiled arrangement, and then it must be unzipped, exposing both strands in order for them to be copied. So an enzyme called DNA helicase does this, first by unwinding the DNA, and then by breaking the hydrogen bonds between the bases. So an enzyme then called primase makes primers, which are just short stretches of DNA and RNA nucleotides. The primer binds to the DNA, and this allows the DNA polymerase, which is another enzyme, to start adding on nucleotides and joining them along their backbone by catalyzing condensation reactions, causing phosphodiester bonds to form. So you can see all of this in this diagram here. So the new DNA strand forms in the 5-to-3 direction. So on the leading strand, this can just go along in the 5-to-3 direction and continuously add on new nucleotides as the helicase opens up the DNA. On the lagging strand, however, it can't do this. Since it can only go in the 5-to-3 direction, it has to form a series of short stretches of DNA, and then it will come off and do another short stretch. Another enzyme, therefore, is then needed, called DNA ligase, which then goes along and joins these short stretches together. So these shorter sequences on the lagging strand are known as Okazaki fragments. So obviously, it is very important that DNA is replicated correctly. The accumulation of errors in DNA in a particular cell increases the risk of diseases such as cancer developing, particularly if the mutations are in genes involved in cell division and regulation, since this can result in uncontrolled cell division that leads to the formation of a tumour. So it is imperative then that mutations are kept to a minimum. So errors in replicating DNA or damage to DNA, for instance by UV light, is actually very common, but it doesn't usually develop into an actual mutation, since our cells have various processes in place to help with this, such as proofreading and repair mechanisms. If these can't fix the problem, then a cell will often undergo programmed cell death, also known as apoptosis, so that it won't pass these mistakes then on to the next generation of cells. So processes that help keep the integrity of DNA include the ability for DNA polymerase to proofread as it adds on nucleotides. So if it adds on an incorrect nucleotide that doesn't complementary base pair with the template strand, then it can remove this and add on the correct one. Mistakes which are made and missed by the polymerase can be fixed by another group of proteins that can recognise mistakes and cut out the piece of DNA containing the error. This might be something like a small insertion or a mismatched base. DNA polymerase can then come along and replace the nucleotides that have been removed. However, if the mistake is not recognised, then this error in replicating will become a mutation after the next cell cycle. So for example, if the error was a mismatched base, so instead of a T, a G had been added, then once the DNA separates again to be replicated, this G will bind with a new C, and at that point in the strand there will then be a GC pair instead of the AT pair that there should have been. This mutation will now persist since it will no longer be recognised as an error, and the mutation will persist to subsequent daughter cells. Right, so we're now going to have a look at cystic fibrosis as an example of how a mutation can cause a genetic disease. So So cystic fibrosis is caused by mutations in the cystic fibrosis transmembrane conductance regulator gene, or the CFTR gene. So everyone has two copies of this gene, one from the mother, one from the father. The pattern of inheritance for this is recessive, meaning that both copies of the CFTR gene would need to have a mutation if someone was actually going to exhibit cystic fibrosis. So if someone has just one copy of a mutation in this gene, then they are known as a carrier. So in someone with cystic fibrosis, the mutations cause either no CFTR protein to be made or a truncated or incorrectly folded CFTR protein that cannot function properly in the cell. And depending on what mutation you have and how severe then the impact this is on the protein will then decide how severe your symptoms are. And we'll look at this in a little bit more detail in a minute. So what does CFTR do then? What is the CFTR protein? Well, it is very important in the cell for acting as an ion channel in the cell membrane. Now this particular ion channel moves chloride ions from inside the cell to outside the cell. Now this is crucial in somewhere like, for example, the lungs. So these chloride ions on the inside the cell are moved out, and on the outside then of the cell, water molecules are then attracted to these chloride ions. Now this creates a nice layer of water around the cell, and this allows tiny hairs called cilia to be able to function effectively. So they move backwards and forwards and they sweep up mucus and other debris that can get into your lungs, up and out of the lungs. Now in someone with cystic fibrosis, it will depend on the mutation, of course, as to whether they have no channels, fewer channels, or perhaps a channel that doesn't work properly and doesn't really open. But to one degree or another then, the concentration of chloride ions will end up much higher inside the cells than it should be, since they're not obviously being moved out of the cell effectively. Now if they're not being moved outside the cell as they should be, then the water layer outside the cell won't form. And this means that everything gets very dehydrated. The surrounding fluid will actually become thick and mucus-like. This means that then the cilia can't work effectively, and if they can't sweep backwards and forwards effectively, they can't clear out debris and mucus and things out of the lungs. So someone with cystic fibrosis then can find it very hard to breathe, they have a lot of mucus in their lungs, and also they're very prone to getting infections, since bacteria like to breed in an environment like that with plenty of mucus there, and the bacteria can also not be cleared out of the lungs by the cilia. So repeated respiratory infections then are very common in those with cystic fibrosis. The CFTR protein is not just important in behaving as an ion channel in the lungs, it's also important in both the digestive system and the reproductive system. So those with cystic fibrosis have problems with their digestive system, since the duct between the pancreas, where the digestive enzymes are made, and the intestines become blocked again with this mucus like we saw in the lungs. So again, this is due to the ion channel not expelling chloride ions as they should, which means that those with cystic fibrosis struggle to break down their food since they're lacking in the digestive enzymes which would normally come across from the pancreas. So additionally then, those with cystic fibrosis can also have problems with reproduction. So in men, in the vas deferens, the sperm cannot swim through this tube due to, again, a mucus buildup, like we saw in both the lungs and the digestive system. And this makes actually almost all men with cystic fibrosis infertile. Although nowadays they can still father children because of infertility treatments that are available. So in women then, this thickening of the mucus in their reproductive tract can make it harder for the sperm to swim to the egg, making it then harder to get pregnant. Okay, so let's just recap then. So in DNA part two, we have covered DNA replication, and we have also looked at how replication errors can lead to mutations and how our cells try and combat these errors. But sometimes when they can't, mutations can arise. And we've then been over cystic fibrosis as an example of a genetic disease. So join me for our next video, in which we are going to be extracting DNA from fruit at home. How are we going to be doing this? Well, we're going to be finding a novel use for your hand sanitizer, which obviously is predominantly alcohol. Now we usually use alcohol to precipitate the DNA when we extract it. So I thought, since we're all at home and we all probably have plenty of hand sanitizer at the moment, if you don't, then obviously don't do this. But if you've got plenty, we're going to be using hand sanitizer to precipitate DNA found in your fruit. So all you're going to need then for this experiment is some fruit. So some soft fruit works really well. So something like a banana, kiwi fruit, strawberries. You'll then also need, obviously, the hand sanitizer. And you will need some washing up liquid, some salt, some water. And if you have a coffee filter, that works really well. If you don't, which I don't, then a few sheets of kitchen roll will do. So I'll see you all next time then for another fun at home science experiment. Thank you.